I want to welcome everybody again to our fourth in this series of six webinars about Baha'u'llah's three declarations. Today, Shahrukh Monjazeb is going to speak about further about the Madinatul Sabr, the City of Patience. And I guess there's nothing else I need to say to introduce you, Shahrukh, so I'll just turn off my microphone and camera and listen like everyone else. Thank you, Shahrukh, for offering this to us. We're really grateful.
Thank you, Dr. Stockman. Good to be here. We're going to pick up where we left off last time. We spoke about Rizwan festivity really commemorates the second phase of Baha'u'llah's declaration. This declaration was still somewhat mystical and secretive in the sense that it was only introduced to a select group of people. It was a more or less a private declaration of Baha'u'llah. As Abdu'l-Bahá has stated explicitly in his writings that on the very first day, Baha'u'llah, when he entered the garden, he declared himself to be him whom God shall make manifest. And then we made mention of the fact that on this very auspicious day, a momentous tablet was revealed by Baha'u'llah entitled Madinatul Sabr, or the City of Patience. And we're going to spend the remaining part of this webinar focusing on this tablet and highlighting some of its key themes. And as I said, you know, in the last webinar, that this tablet really deserves a course on its own. And we don't have the time to really delve too much into it. But as you will see, it's replete with very rich content that has a tremendous spiritual ramification, as well as aspects to it that have historical dimensions, as well as foreshadowing of the future. So we'll explore together some facets of it. But before I begin where I left off last time, there were several things that I thought would be worth mentioning, and perhaps somewhat would be intriguing for those who are very interested in this event and how Baha'u'llah describes the Rizwan itself. First of all, the name Madinatul Sabr, the City of Patience. Have we heard the term city before? Yes, we have. In the Kitab-i-Iqan, Baha'u'llah refers to it as the City of Certitude, which he says then it is the Word of God. And it's in that passage that's very famous now. Many friends like to read and meditate. It's often referred to as, quote unquote, the tablet of the true seeker. It's the excerpt from the gleanings that it is from the Iqan, from the Kitab al-Iqan, the Book of Certitude. It's the excerpt 125, which roughly in the old edition was page 264 to 270, where Baha'u'llah talks about a true seeker. And at the end of that, where that true seeker goes through several stages, it will attain to the City of Certitude. And so this Madinatul Iqan, he says, or Madinay Iqan. Now, during the Baghdad period, it's interesting to note that there were other tablets and other themes of the city was also mentioned. There is the there's a tablet that excerpts of it has been translated by the beloved guardian in the gleanings, and that is Madinatul Tawheed, or the City of Oneness, City of Oneness of God, if you will. And I believe this tablet was revealed to Sheikh Salman. I do believe that, but I may be wrong. But it is mentioned by Mr. Tahirzadeh in his first volume of the Revelation of Baha'u'llah. Then there is another tablet which we don't know much about and has not been readily available even in its original language. It was once published in Asar al-Qalama Ala, Volume 4, and that is Madinatul Reza, or Madinatul Reda, or Madinatul Reza, as we say in Persian, is the city of radiant acquiescence, which has been translated by Mr. Tahirzadeh as, and he gives a certain description of it, but that tablet is in Arabic, and again, worth studying. And then here we have the city of patience, or Madinatu Sabr. So this raises the question: what are these cities? And perhaps one could look at it this way: that as one journeys, as a seeker journeys in the wilderness of search, if you will, and seeks a destination, and that destination are these cities, and attaining to these cities that are very important and part of the spiritual journey of the individual. But I just wanted to kind of highlight that for you. This is a theme particularly during the Baghdad period, and these tablets that I mentioned to you, including in the Iran, were all revealed during the Baghdad period. Now, another note about something very intriguing, I came across it several years ago, but it was pointed out by Dr. Mujan Momen on Tarjuman several years ago, and was further enhanced and added to by Dr. Khazef Ananopazir, which is very intriguing. There is an excerpt from a tablet of Baha'u'llah in which Baha'u'llah refers to the event many years later, to the event of Rizwan, and he says that the name, very interesting, he says that the name of Rizwan was given based on the name of the gatekeeper of the Garden of Paradise in the spiritual world, and it was very intriguing. And then Dr. Khazef Ananopazir brought this up. He's very well versed in a lot of the Quranic traditions and many of the writings of the two luminaries, precursors, if you will, of the Bab, Sheikh Ahmad Ahsai and Sayyid Kazim Rashidi. And he writes that, and I will read some of his comments here, that he says that Rizwan, referred to by the immortal Sheikh Ahmad Ahsai as the doorkeeper of all the gardens of paradise. And he says in his Sharh al-Ziyara, Volume 4, it's one of his great works, he says that, let's see, and it says, and there appeared Rizwan, the gatekeeper or the janitor of the Garden of Paradise, peace be upon him. And then there's also another person here. It says, in other words, Rizwan is the doorkeeper or the gatekeeper of the garden, and another personage, Malik, is the guard of the fire, and this is very, very interesting. So so according to the hadith of Sheikh Ahmad's, then Rizwan gives all the keys of paradise to Imam Ali on the Day of Judgment. And here the reference to Ali Muhammad, is the Bab. And so these are all very interesting. And he says that Shoghi Effendi quotes an excerpt from a letter, one of the letters of the Bab to Muhammad Shah, where he says, I am the primal point from which have been generated all created things, all the keys of heaven God hath chosen to place on my right hand, and all the keys of hell on my left. So again, this imagery, these metaphors, these mystical metaphors that are being used here are quite intriguing. However, as I mentioned to you last time, Baha'u'llah says the full scope and understanding of the nature of that day is beyond the apprehension and comprehension of people of this plane, if you will. And I guess in some ways that's an indication to me that don't spend too much time on it. You won't be able to understand too much about that. So it is still shrouded in a lot of mysticism and spiritual secrecy, if you will, that will be revealed to those whom God wills, and perhaps in another plane. Okay, now we want to venture back into the tablet. The first excerpt of the tablet, if you recall, I had made some translations of last time, and I had made a translation and I had gone over it with you, and it was primarily dealt with the ministry of Job and the story of Job, which was rather intriguing and very interesting. And then towards the end, Baha'u'llah digresses from that theme and goes into another themes, and one of them was about patience. So here, continuing on, and I don't have, because there's no paginations or paragraph numbering, you'll just have to go back to the translation when you are following this webinar, which is the one that is we've provided the link for you on bahailibrary.org.com. And just go to Khaz's translation and just follow in. I'm using primarily his translation here as a provisional translation. As I said, it's a very good translation, and it is worth studying it using that translation. Of course, every translation can constantly be tweaked and improved upon pending the authorized translation by the Baha'i World Center, but at this point we don't have that, so we have to suffice ourselves to the one that we do have by Dr. Khazen Fanonapazi. So further on, Baha'u'llah says, truly blessed is the one who arrays himself with a garment of patience. And then he goes on to say, soon will God cause him to be manifest within the canopy of grandeur with a luminous garment which will scintillate like unto scintillation of light above the spiritual horizon, and eyes will be dazzled upon beholding him, and above his head there will be a caller from God saying, this is verily the one who was long-suffering for God in the vain and futile world, and in all that the unbelievers did unto him. And then he goes on and addresses the people of Bayan, says, O people of the Bayan, be patient in these passing days and do not complain. Further know ye that for all good things there is ordained a limited reward in the book of God, with the exception of patience. This is the point that we made by God unto Muhammad, the Apostle of God. And then quoting from the Quran, those who patiently persevere will truly receive a reward without measure. And this is Quran chapter 39, verse 10. This has been referred by Baha'u'llah on other occasions as well in his tablets, that essentially, God says that for every good deed, for every virtuous act, God has designated a reward, a certain measure of reward, if you will. And then he goes on to say that, however, except patience, where for those who are patient, the reward is unlimited. And this is, Baha'u'llah reminds us of this verse from the Quran. Now, this element of patience, as you will see here, as I mentioned to you, goes along with the actual nature of the day, in which Baha'u'llah has very quietly and selectively has chosen to reveal his station verbally to this group, the small band of his companions. And who were these companions besides his sons? Abdul Baha, Mirza Mehdi, and Mirza Muhammad Ali was a young child at the time. But people like Mirza Munire Kashani, who is known as Ismullah al-Munib, he's the one who was one of Baha'u'llah's scribes, and we have the original transcription of the Jawahir al-Asrar, the Gems of Divine Mystery, is in his hand, and that's, you have a small copy of it that the House of Justice have provided in the opening pages of the Gems of Divine Mystery. So that's the handwriting, and he had a beautiful handwriting. It was from Kashan, and he was one of the early believers, and he's considered as one of the companions of Baha'u'llah throughout. But he passes on, he becomes sick and passes on during Baha'u'llah's exile to Akka. So he travels with Baha'u'llah from Baghdad, so he served Baha'u'llah in Baghdad and then later in Adrianople, but he eventually becomes ill on the way, on the journey away from, on the way to Akka, and there's a story of it, you know, the late hand of the cause of God. Abu al-Qasim Faizi has written a beautiful account of Baha'u'llah's journey and the passing, and the sickness and then the passing of Ismullah al-Munib or Mirza Munir Kashani. So Mirza Munir was one of them. Nabil Azam was one of them. Nabil Akbar may have been one of them. Again, we don't know. There's a list of companions that we have that Mr. Balyuzi has provided. It's also in Zuhur al-Hab as well. Fazl Mazandarani has made mention of those who accompanied Baha'u'llah from Baghdad, because not all the companions were allowed to travel with Baha'u'llah. Baha'u'llah asked that many remain behind, and many did. So, you know, we can only imagine. There's a very small band of followers of Baha'u'llah that were privy to this announcement, and I believe that this tablet, when it was revealed, it was shared with those companions initially, and that it was not, this tablet, the City of Patience, was not openly shared with others. As I said to you, the other document that we have that is that was written by Abdu'l-Bahá during the stay, the 12-day sojourn in the garden, does not make mention of anything explicitly about Baha'u'llah's announcement, because Baha'u'llah had asked that they would keep this secret still with themselves until the appointed time. And there are instructions as well in this tablet, as we will see, that Baha'u'llah invites his companions and those who are faithful to remain still patient, because there will be a more public announcement to come, and hence Baha'u'llah's public proclamation, which took place 3 years later in Adrianople. And here it is, the next paragraph, or the second paragraph after that, after he talks about the theme of patience and stresses patience, he goes on a little bit further. It says, "Anticipate ye therefore the day when the clouds of patience shall be uplifted, and the immortal bird shall warble, and the peacock of holiness shall be made manifest with the ornament of revelation in the kingdom of his reunion. And the stammering tongue shall be freed, singing the accents of the nightingale, and the dove of paradise shall sing between earth and heaven, and the trumpet shall be sounded, and bodies of existence shall all be renewed, and the divine fire shall be ignited, and God, in his transcendent and glorious beauty, shall come in the clouds of the Spirit." So, this definitely is a foreshadowing of a far more public annunciation by Baha'u'llah yet to come. At the end of that paragraph, he goes on just to also say, "This has been revealed by the pen of the Omniscient One." So all these undercurrents, if you will, I mean, if you read between the lines, definitely is unveiling of Baha'u'llah's station and his authority, but yet he has requested that his beloved companions keep this to themselves until the appointed hour will. It should be openly announced to the entire population of the world, and he does that with the kings and rulers in Surah Al-Muluk, and also to a lesser extent, if you will, to the Babi community with Surah Haykal as well, which I believe those two tablets were revealed around the same time, and we'll discuss it in the next webinar. Then going further, Baha'u'llah again makes reference to the Bab and denounces those who refused to believe in him when he was sent down by God, and also rose against him. And he says, "Say to them, O ignorant ones, did we not reveal in the past a day that God shall come in the canopies of the clouds? How is it that when he came down in the clouds of revelation in the temple of Ali, you turned away and rejected him and waxed haughty and brought about your own perdition?" Again, this is the question. And then he challenges them. He says, "Was it not also revealed in your book the day when thy Lord comes, or certain of the signs of thy Lord?" And then end the quote. And then and when he did come with evident signs, wherefore did ye turn away from those signs and veiled yourself with the veils of self? And then in the next paragraph, he goes on to say again, he did come in the name of Ali. And this is also you will see in Surah Al-Muluk in the second paragraph. He also castigates the kings for not recognizing and not hearkening to the call of the Bab when he revealed himself. You know, the Bab in the very night of his declaration on May 22nd, 1844, in that night of power and excellence in the presence of Mullah Hussein al-Bushri'i, he revealed the first chapter of Qayyum al-Asma, Surah al-Mulk, the Surah of Dominion, or the Chapter of Dominion, and in the Chapter of Dominion, there is a proclamation to the kings of the world. And so you will see that Baha'u'llah goes back to that and says that you missed it, and now this is the second time you're going to be summoned. You missed the first summons, and now this is the second summons. But we'll come back to that the next webinar. And then he goes on to address the people of Qur'an, say, O people of the Qur'an, ponder ye in the book that was revealed in truth unto Muhammad, in which he sealed prophethood with the coming of his beloved prophet until the day of resurrection. But this day is the day of resurrection, whereon God has risen in the manifestation of his self, but you have become veiled from it, just as the peoples before have become veiled on the advent of Muhammad, and you have become drowned in the depths of an ocean of ignorance and denial. So this is the challenge to the Muslim population. And then he goes on and challenges them again and says, say, were ye not promised attaining the presence of God in the day of God? But when the promise did come and the beauty shone above the horizon of glory, you turned your gaze away and were resurrected blind in the plain of resurrection. Very interesting. Again, this challenge goes on, and you can further read this throughout the tablet. And it's very interesting that there are parallels between this theme, and I know there is a perhaps a paper done. I haven't read the paper, but I think I was told that it's quite a good paper. Fouad Siddiq, I believe, that was published in The Lights of Irfan, and there is a comparative study of the theme of this tablet and of the Qayyum al-Asma and the references made. There is the solace of the eyes of eternity, which is Qurratul Ayn, which the Bab uses to refer to himself in the Qayyum al-Asma, and it's also one of the titles of Tahireh, but in this case it's a reference to the manifestation, the solace of the eye. And then it goes on and talks about the pen of revelation. O pen of revelation, thou seest and bearest witness that beings do not seek this outspread bountiful mercy that encompasses all the heavens and the earth, and seek not to turn to the countenance from whom the light of the Spirit shineth forth. So, pen of revelation, these are all, again, subtle yet to some degree direct references to the station of Baha'u'llah and Baha'u'llah's authority at this juncture, now with his mandate being somewhat disclosed to the world, and he being enthroned on his throne of glory as the supreme manifestation of God for this new age of humanity. The next dimension of this tablet is where Baha'u'llah recounts the event of one of the heroic upheavals in the ministry of the Bab. And that was the Nairiz upheaval. Nairiz is a small town near Yazd, and the valiant defense and heroic acts of Vahid, Sayyid Yahya Darabi, and his followers. If you recall from the Dawnbreakers that the Nairiz insurrection, if you will, took place, and it came to its tragic end few days, literally few days before the martyrdom of the Bab, in late June of 1850. That's the first upheaval of the Nairiz, with Vahid as being the the valiant leader of that. And this was the region where he came from. Dorob is near in that. These are villages and small little towns that that were close to Yazd and that whole region. And it's very interesting that Baha'u'llah singles out the people of Nayriz and their acts. I found that very, very fascinating. But when I was reflecting on this, I really thought to myself that it's probably the most prominent. I mean, we've had insurrections at the fort of Sheikh Tabarsi, but the fort of Sheikh Tabarsi was this enclave in the jungles of Mazandaran that the faithful believers came and had to defend themselves against the onslaught of the enemies. But so it was not a necessarily a destination city or where the people lived there. In Zanjan later, with Hojat and the Zanjan insurrection that followed Nayriz and the martyrdom of the Bab, again, it was an incredible event for sure, not to undermine its significance at all. But it seems with Nayriz, because it took place twice, the first upheaval was in 1850, just few days. It came to a head a few days before the martyrdom of the Bab. And then the third one, the second upheaval, which was in 1853, it culminated around the November of 1853. So that would have clearly have taken place during the ministry of Baha'u'llah after the birth of the new revelation, even though they were being persecuted as the Babis. And that one was even more ferocious than the first one. And you can read, in fact, in the first section of Nabil's narrative, the one that has been translated by Shoghi Effendi, towards the end, it does talk about the second Nayriz upheaval and the brutal massacre. In fact, the decapitation of about 200 Babis, and how their heads were their heads were bayoneted and were their heads were they had decided that they were going to take these heads to the capital. And on their way from Shiraz, because they had taken these prisoners in Shiraz, and they were murdered in Shiraz, and then they set about to bring it to the capital, and in the city of Abadeh, they received a message from the government that they should abstain from doing so, and the heads were buried, I believe, unceremoniously. In this mass grave, and it is truly an incredible and a tragic and brutal testament to the genocide of the Babis, and one dimension of their genocide by the hands of the clergies and the government of Iran in the 19th century. So here there is a reference to Vahid. Actually, there are a few references to Vahid and the people of Nayriz, and also Haji Muhammad Taghi Nayrizi that we mentioned. Many Baha'i scholars have even said that this tablet was revealed in memory and honoring Haji Muhammad Taghi. Now, Haji Muhammad Taghi was an incredible soul. Mr. Tahirzadeh gives a wonderful account of him in English in the first volume of Revelation of Baha'u'llah, which I invite you to go and read. He was a genuine soul who had become one of the champions of the cause of the Bab and a great supporter of Vahid with his financial means, and he sponsored with his own money, the the defenders, and Baha'u'llah acknowledges that he, because he was also wealthy, he when the time came with the execution of many of these, the first defenders, if you will, of the first upheaval, he was spared, and because they wanted to extort more money from him. And he was brutally tortured, and some of that is mentioned by Mr. Tahirzadeh, where they would, in the winter, an icy condition, they would submerge him naked into a pool of water. They would break the ice and they submerge him in there, and then they would beat him and flog him, if you will, till he would bleed. And the order from the government was that the pool should become red with his blood before they would relent. And they would do that almost on a daily basis to him. And eventually, miraculously, he is set free. And you'll read the account, and then he travels about 1,500 kilometers or so on a long journey to Baghdad to be with Baha'u'llah, and he resides for a number of years in Baghdad, and then he passes away in Baghdad. So here Baha'u'llah is honoring his memory as one of the valiant defenders, but I don't believe necessarily that this tablet is dedicated to him. As I've said, I believe this tablet is far greater in its significance to be dedicated to one individual. And if anything, as far as person goes, Vahid is repeatedly referred to by name as Vahid, and also by his first given name, Yahya. Now, just a quick word about Vahid. I have mentioned it in my other webinars, but truly one of the most, if not the most, outstanding followers of the Bab, due to his erudition and his piety. And if you recall, he was commissioned by the Shah, Muhammad Shah, to go and investigate the cause of the Bab, and he travels from his land. I believe he may have been in Tehran at the time, but he's commissioned by the Shah from amongst all the learned clergies. So obviously he was very prominent in the eyes of the king, to go and investigate the cause of the Bab. And he does that in 1846. He has made there's an account of him where he says he gives the date of his first interview, and that is also in the Dawnbreakers as well, the manner in which he goes and attains the presence of the Bab through his in Shiraz, I believe, through his uncle, his Khala Azam, Haj Mirza Sayyid Ali, his middle uncle, who had become a guardian of the Bab, and when the Bab was arrested in Shiraz under house arrest, it was in the house of his uncle that he was under house arrest. These are all mentioned in the Dawnbreakers. So Sayyid Yahya was truly a remarkable man. You know, Abdul Baha, in one of his talks speaking about Vahid, and Sayyid Yahya Darabi, says that this brilliant man knew in excess of 30,000 hadith, okay, traditions, by heart. So he definitely was a remarkable man. And if you recall, when we studied Rasha Amal, the explanation that the Bab gave in his commentary was actually addressed to Sayyid Yahya. So we can thank Vahid and Sayyid Yahya, you know, the same person, obviously. We can thank him for bringing that up, and hence the Bab clarified the word Amal, you know, and this unknowable essence of God where he comments on. So here, I mean, it's really, we don't have the time, but really, you know, you can go through it and look at how he Baha'u'llah honors the memory and elevates the station of Vahid and recounts in detail the circumstances of his martyrdom and how he was, how courageous he was in the words that he uttered. There's also an apostrophe to the peoples of Nehriz that Baha'u'llah says, "Thank ye God, your Creator, who vouchsafed his bounty upon you," to the people of Nehriz, "preferred you upon the peoples of the earth, honored you with attaining his presence, made you aware of his own self, nourished you from the fruits of the tree of paradise at a time when all were depriving themselves of it as well." It is worth mentioning that there's a recently in the last several years has been an excellent book called Awakening, A History of the Babi and Baha'i Faiths in Nehriz. This one by Hussein Ahdieh and Hilary Chapman. And I found that to be a quite fascinating read. And it has some gems, historical gems as well. And it's based on some of the primary, previously unpublished accounts of some of the eyewitnesses to many of these events as well. And it's published by Baha'i Publishing Trust, Wilmette. And so certainly the whole story of Nehriz and how God singles Vahid, his followers, and the people of Nehriz for having risen valiantly in the service of the cause of God. In another reference to the people of Nehriz, Baha'u'llah denounces the clergies, and I thought this is very interesting to bring that to your attention. "O peoples of Nehriz, recall the bounty of God wherewith he was graciously vouchsafed unto you, and whereby he has taught you what he has not taught the divines of the earth. Divines," and he talks about divines, "who because of the great size of their turbans cannot even walk on earth, and when they move, it is as if a mountain of hatred moves." Very, very challenging. Then he continues, Baha'u'llah, again, extensively about the events of the first upheaval and how it came to a head through the treachery of the enemies and the treachery that we saw with the fourth of Sheikh Tabarsi as well, where the Quran was sealed and was put on a spear and as a sign of truce that the people would remain unharmed. And yet, when the defenders let down their guards and came out of the fort, they were arrested and then brutally murdered. And then Vahid himself was a subject of this treachery. And Baha'u'llah recounts, "They took Vahid, they dishonored him, they made his body naked, and they perpetrated against that body what causes the eyes of the people of paradise to shed tears of blood." Now, after spending a great section of the tablet reminding the world of the steadfastness of and the sacrifice of the people of Nehriz, including Sayyid Yahya Dorabi, the great Vahid, and his followers, such as Haji Muhammad Taqi Nehrizi, which Baha'u'llah acknowledges for his wealth. In fact, I meant to share that with you, where he says, let's go back to that. Okay, yes, he says those who assist God with their wealth and their lives and who are patient under all conditions of hardship for the purpose of attracting God's good pleasure, these are the ones who shall attain victory for all eternity, for all eternity. And indeed, Baha'u'llah has placed a very special station, a very, very special and very high rank for those faithful believers who are very affluent. And we have a great example of that in the King and the Beloved of the Martyrs, who truly are my personal heroes. I have always found their story to be of incredible inspiration. And, you know, Shoghi Effendi ranks them, ranks the King of the Martyrs third amongst his apostles, first after Baha'u'llah's brother, Mirza Musa, who's the first apostle in the list in the Baha'i world. There's 19 apostles. And then Badi, the young, the pride of the martyrs, is second. And then the King of the Martyrs is ranked third. And he truly, they were truly an incredible and faithful scions, and they were also loved by their community. So these examples, these shining examples, that Baha'u'llah has even said in the Persian Hidden Words that the light that will generate, will emanate from these great wealthy ones who are truly detached, where he says wealth is a mighty barrier between the lover and the beloved. And then he says, and I'm paraphrasing in that Hidden Words, it's in the Persian Hidden Words, where he says that if they are not prevented by the attraction of wealth, if you will, if they become detached, that does not allow this barrier, or they break this barrier, this mighty barrier between the lover and the beloved, and yet be able to expend their wealth for the promotion of the cause of God. He says the light that will emanate from these souls will illuminate the heavens and the earth. So a truly mighty station for those who have been blessed with wealth, material wealth, that can serve the cause of God with steadfastness and with detachment from these material, the material wealth that has been bestowed upon them, as Baha'u'llah says, by God. Baha'u'llah then shifts again back to the nature of his revelation and the revelation of this day, towards the end of the tablet, where he says, O solace of the eye of eternity, and then goes on and says, change your tone and chant upon the melodies of those nightingales singing in the tabernacle of divine name and in the dominions of divine attributes, that the birds of the throne may detach themselves from the dust of themselves and may therefore turn back to their original homeland, which is sanctified beyond transcendence. And goes on and says, O thou quintessence of truth, sing and chant with the most beauteous melodies, for all the maidens of paradise have come out of their assemblies and their tents of purity, that they may hear your own melody, the melody that has been sung in the pages of God in the book Qayyum al-Asma. You know, Qayyum al-Asma is really, in its true essence, it talks about the story of, even though it's a commentary on the Surah of Joseph, the divine Joseph is Baha'u'llah, that the Bab is speaking, essentially, in Qayyum al-Asma, even though it's very multifaceted and very rich, but ultimately, the word Qayyum, the self-subsisting of all names, is Baha. And it's a reference to Baha'u'llah. So here, the voice of call is of God beckoning that the pen of revelation Institute and Baha'u'llah that he should sing his own praises. He's remembering the Bab and his revelation and his followers, and here he is being pulled, if you will, or being encouraged that he should speak of his own new melodies, that he should sing his own melodies. And and again, very mystical interplay between the voice of God and the person of the new manifestation. O thou most holy beauty, the paragraph that begins with that, and then it says, thou knowest that I have now become afflicted between the unbelievers from two parties, and thou commandest in both revelations and overseest both dispensations, and thou art manifest in the twin garments, and thou art resplendent through the two suns, and have been mentioned with the twin names, possess the twin dawning places, commandest the secret of the twin mysteries in these two lines, and God is fully aware beyond all this. So this reference to the twin being the twin revelation of the Bab and Baha'u'llah, and now that essentially the second portion of this twin manifestationhood, if you will, this ultimate reality is now being fulfilled and is taking charge and is set in motion, if you will, in this day, the great day of God that is inaugurated publicly yet privately in this Garden of Rizwan on 22nd of April 1863. And then Baha'u'llah continues, thou knowest that I have no fear for myself, rather I have sacrificed myself, my soul, and my spirit on the day that thou graciously honored me with thy presence, the day that thou made me recognize thy new beauty and inspired me with the gems of thy revelation, which are shed upon everyone that entereth the shade of thy cause. Thus have we explained everything in a tablet that is revealed from the heaven of the Divine Spirit. And then there's other references. O thou blood-soaked garment, this could be a reference to both the Bab as well as Imam Hussein. And Dr. Fanon-Pazir in the footnote says there are many references in the Qayyum al-Asma to the blood-soaked garment. Their original story is from the Quran, the Surah of Joseph. Blood-soaked garment is brought to his father, Joseph. In the Bab's writing, this blood becomes the blood of Imam Hussein. This blood-soaked garment, according to the Bab, proclaims, verily, I am God. This is a reference to the spiritual return of Imam Hussein, which is the person of Baha'u'llah. So again, it's very profound and very much deeply rooted in the Islamic tradition as well. And in the next paragraph after that, say, this tablet enjoins upon you patience on this day of the great terror. And the following paragraph, very interesting, there's a reference to Amah, the horizon of Amah. Although Khazeh has translated as horizon of eternity, but in the original is the horizon of Amah, that I've made a point of just making a note here. And there's a reference to Baghdad, the abode of peace, the city of separation, and then finally towards the very end, the last few paragraphs, O thou quintessence of sorrow. He says, seal thou the utterance in this remembrance, for we have truly become saddened, and the concourse on high have become sorrowful. And then make mention of that servant of God who asked of that true and veritable great announcement. Say, I swear by the one true God, that announcement came to pass in the perspicuous beauty of Ali. But the servants disagreed about it, and the divines of the age objected to him, divines who were veiled in the veils of self. And you did recognize the beauty of God in the raiment of Ali, the self-subsisting, and ere long all in the heavens and earth will recognize him. And this was previously inscribed in truth and has been irrevocable with God, and ye shall know of his announcement at an inevitably approaching time. So this sentence here, and then ye shall know of his announcement, again, now the announcement, now the transition between, you know, the Ali and now the return of Hussein, his announcement at an inevitably approaching time. So it is inevitable, he says, and it is approaching, but he doesn't disclose to them when is that going to take place. Okay, I think that's all I wanted to say about the tablet. As I said, I just wanted to highlight some of the major themes of this tablet. This tablet really deserves a much deeper study, hopefully in future. Maybe there will be an authorized translation of it coming. I'm not aware of that, but irregardless, it is certainly worth exploring. It just makes it a little bit more challenging for those who do not have a command of the Arabic language. But for those friends in the West who know Arabic and like or can explore this tablet, I mean, it is a treasure house of mystical dimensions, and truly an incredible tablet. As I've said, it's very awe-inspiring. Each time I read it, it opens up new dimensions and sheds new light on Baha'u'llah's declaration and his person, and also many other dimensions, which particularly that of patience, you know, that has been greatly praised and is amongst the supreme virtues which we're all called upon to exercise. Okay, friends, I think I will end the talk here, and then if there are any questions, Dr. Stockman, if we can have your assistance here, that would be great.
Sure. Yeah, I thank you so much, Charles. This is really fantastic. And I have not looked at the tablet myself, so I had not realized that it was referring to Nehri's and to Vahid and all of these people. So I was fascinated to hear that Baha'u'llah was recapitulating the sacrifice of the friends to date, let alone the ones coming up. Mm-hmm. The sacrifice of the next 30 years. We don't have any particular questions yet. One person asked what document was he reading from and then realized which document it was. Another person had been trying to get in and goodness, finally got in. Thank goodness, Carol. I'm glad you made it. She and I have been emailing for the last half hour back and forth a few times to see if we could figure out what the problem was. Excuse me. You said that you didn't think this document, this tablet had been circulated. Right, it was pretty much just for the friends there in the Garden of Rizwan.
Yes.
When was the document circulated, do you know?
Many of these tablets, I believe, once Baha'u'llah's public announcement was made in the summer of 1866, many of these tablets will later on were transcribed and became published. You know, the collation and transcription of tablets really took place in the for the purpose of dissemination amongst the believers and publication really in 1870s and 1880s when Baha'u'llah had taken up residence in Akka. And also there was a press owned, a publishing house owned in India, in Bombay, by the Afnans, the Nasiri Press, and the first publications, lithographed publication of the Kitab-e-Iran and the Kitab-e-Aqdas were made during Baha'u'llah's life, you know, in Bombay, in India. And in fact, at one point, Baha'u'llah sent his son, Mirza Muhammad Ali, and at another time, I believe, Abdul Baha, or even Baha'u'llah, through Baha'u'llah's instructions, Mishkin Ghalam, the great calligrapher, to India to transcribe these and put together a collection of tablets. We have two collections in the handwriting of Mishkin Ghalam. One is called Iqtidarat, the other one called Ishraqat. Although there's a tablet called Ishraqat, but this is a collection. It's a very valuable and a great treasure house of tablets of Baha'u'llah that has been beautifully transcribed by Mishkin Ghalam and was published in Iran as well. And I think there's a copy of it or were copies of that on the Baha'i World Center's reference Baha'i.org in Persian. And so these publications, again, now, when was it, I mean, I guess going back to your question, when do you think this was more accessible to the friends? I doubt it would have been right away. I doubt, you know, because you will see there's another tablet which I'll make reference to hopefully next time, Surah Al-Ashab, the Surah of the Companions, where Baha'u'llah is advising his companions to gradually lift up the veil, you know, even though they are explicit. But he says, when you go to proclaim the message, you should slowly lift up the veil of his beauty. And it was really from Adrianople where he sent the great teachers of the faith to Iran, including Janabe Munib and Nabila Azam. They became these itinerant teachers that went and helped convert many of the Babis to the Baha'i faith. This event is an event that's worth studying historically, because there were a very large number of Babis in Iran. How did these Babis became Baha'is? You know, it was through the efforts, assiduous efforts of these great itinerant teachers like Nabila Azam, you know, that went on several occasions to Iran under Baha'u'llah's instructions to bring the message. So again, these tablets may have been then circulating at that time, but I don't think that they were immediately available to most of the friends.
Mm-hmm. Chuck asks whether you could say more about the mystic aspect of Baha'u'llah's writings. What's the purpose of this style, and what does it mean to one academically challenged? Where can he research the subject further?
Well, Chuck, you know, the mystical elements of Baha'u'llah's revelation, as you will see, is based on the period of his revelation, the period from his hidden declaration in the the Siyah Chal to his open private declaration in the Garden of Rizwan is known as Ayyam-e Butun, the Dales of Concealment. And during this period, the tablets are very mystical in the sense that Baha'u'llah cannot openly come out and say and divulge his station to humanity. So they have these mystical elements. There's this interplay, there's this very secretive way of expressing the message of God. So it has that very romantic yet very mysterious way. So I think the Revelation is very purposeful, that these are not something like poetical works of great Sufi poets necessarily, that, you know, they may have been inspired to write something about their state or the state of the world, but these were really conditioned based on the nature of the time, and therefore they're mystical in that sense. So I think one dimension, and I'm sure there are many other dimensions, but the one that I think we all need to recognize, that, you know, the Baghdad period of Baha'u'llah's revelation were mystical, where he even says in Jawahar al-Asrar that he was in his nest of mysteries. He was commanded to remain concealed by God. So therefore, his message or his writings have those elements to it.
Audel asks, Shahrukh John, thank you for your great review of the Madinah Sabr. He has a question about the word Amar. You mentioned that Vahid had asked the Bab about it. In which Tawbah of the Bab is this, in the Tafsir, Surat al-Kawthar? And could you shed a bit of light about what the word Amar, how it was used and described by the Bab?
Well, Adel John, I have, if you go back to my translation of Rasha Amar, there's a very long footnote. You may have just missed that, but it is there. I make reference to the commentary of the Bab, which is published in Asrar al-Asar, and I make reference to that. So please go to the opening long footnote of the of my provisional translation of Rasha Amar, and you will find it there.
He says, "Thank you. This is in the course. I think in the second unit of the course where we actually look at the Rasha Amar and the Siyah Chal period. I think that's where that document is located, if I remember right."
Yes.
And he says, thank you. I don't see any other questions, but I have another question for you since we've finished talking about this tablet. I suppose I shouldn't ask for you to rate the tablet, but, you know, obviously this is not the most important tablet by Baha'u'llah, which is the Aqdas, or the second most one, which is the Igan, or the third and fourth ones, which are the hidden words in the seven valleys, according to the Guardian, and God passes by. But clearly this is also an important tablet. And I was wondering, I mean, it's in the top 100, the top 50.
Oh, for sure. For sure. It would be in the, I would say it's in probably in the top 20, if not top 10. Yes, they are. It's very hard to rank Baha'u'llah's tablets, but yeah. this you know, in the same way that I believe, you know, the House of Justice decided to translate provide the authorized translation of Gems of Divine Mysteries about 12, 13 years ago, this would probably get published in some very similar format as that. Because it is, you know, Mr. Tahir Zadeh refers to it as being quarter the size of the Kitab-i-Ighan. So it is one of the lengthy tablets of Baha'u'llah. I believe it's a very significant tablet, and its theme and its multifaceted themes, if you will, are very much conducive to the better understanding of the Revelation, and there are some beautiful gems in there, and some one-liner guidances that I think the Western believers would treasure. So it's just a matter of priority. I know that ultimately the House of Justice, as the trustees of the Word of God, want to offer all of these great works of Baha'u'llah to humanity. I mean, they're not, you know, I think for one, we should never imagine or think for one second that the head of the Baha'i faith is guarding these tablets for whatever reason. They want to, believe me, they have expressed that they have the desire to share this with the world, especially the ones that are being that have been previously published in their original language of Revelation. But, you know, the task of translation and the limited resources that the Baha'i World Center has, it's taking years for this to happen. I know that they are working on several volumes right now of the writings of Baha'u'llah and Abdu'l-Bahá to gift the Baha'i world for the centenary, or sorry, bicentenary of the birth of Baha'u'llah and the Bab. Again, I will say just about this is again my understanding. It's not official, but I believe there are works. It is in the works for having some volumes come out in the next few years. So you know, I don't know what or which. That's up to the House of Justice to decide. But I think you know, I mean, if we go down the priority list, you know, this would be amongst the important works of Baha'u'llah. As I said, I think it's in the top 20. So, you know, we can expect it in the next few decades, hopefully.
And how would you, one other sort of follow-up question on that, how would you rank the difficulty of translating it? Obviously, it's much easier than the Rasha Amal, since it's not poetry. Is it more like the Jawahir al-Asrar?
Yes, it is. Yes, I mean, the Arabic is the Arabic of the Baghdad period. So certainly, yes, it's very similar in the style of Jawahir al-Asrar and other Arabic tablets of that period. It's just the annotations and, you know, I mean, it's not an unattainable work. It is amongst the mystical works of Baha'u'llah, but so is Jawahir al-Asrar. So yeah, I think
the
Seven Valleys. But the fact that the House of Justice have chosen to translate the Jawahir al-Asrar, that was actually very remarkable to see, because you know, the Guardian's reluctance to translate the mystical works of Baha'u'llah. But certainly, the House felt that it was a very useful addition to the library of the creative words. Again, I think that the Madinat al-Sabr is one of the tablets that will be eventually translated, because it is translatable, and it's not very, very mystical, and like some of the other Arabic tablets, like the Loh-e-Hurriye. And I know Loh-e-Hurriye has become very controversial. I'll just take a couple minutes to say about the Loh-e-Hurriye, because it was a question on the forum about the Loh-e-Hurriye. There is a provisional translation of it by a former Baha'i, Professor Juan Ricardo Cole. And there has been commentaries and letters of guidance from the Universal House of Justice on this. So anyone who wants to explore that should read those. And I think they're posted along the same in the Baha'i Library. Now, I caution again, as I did with any of the mystical works as we experienced, that there are many ways of translating it. One has to know the context. One has to really provide great deal of annotations. To just put it out there in the form of a translation, I don't think it's fair to the creative words and to its reader, because most readers who don't have the necessary background, where it's Islamic or Sufi background or anything, they may not really understand, or it could be misleading. And I think that's what the House of Justice has cautioned, and this is why the Guardian was reluctant to do that, because you know, the English language, as rich as it is, you know, it doesn't have some of the elements of the Eastern culture. And so when you translate something that really, as the Guardian calls it, untranslatable, then you're taking liberties, and you are in some ways you are corrupting the essence of it, and we all don't want to do that. So, you know, and as I've said, as we become more mature in our understanding, we will learn these languages of revelation and study it in their original text, you know. So, but yeah, I mean, I think City of Patience is one that could be translated and provided to the Western Baha'is, hopefully in the near future.
Yeah. Well, I don't see any other questions, and I want to thank you very much, especially now that we've got even that context for the importance of this tablet. Really, it's quite a privilege for us to have heard two 75-minute presentations about it, and we now are much better off and much better informed than we could have been otherwise about this extremely important work of Baha'u'llah. And I thank you very much for offering this to the Wilmot Institute and to its learners.